Your limbs are strapped down, and the men standing over you are screaming at you. At first, their words are sharp and clear, but as your brain is slowly deprived of oxygen, you can't hear him so well anymore. You try to hold your breath as the water is forced down your face for minutes at a time. No matter how calm you thought you would be, you can't help that sinking feeling in your gut. The water goes up your nose and flows through all your nasal cavities, making you twinge with sudden cold and desperation. Then you gag on the water, but that only hastens the opening of your bronchial passages to the flow of chill death seeping into your lungs. Your chest feels so tight, like you are coughing on a candy stuck in your throat, but much worse, the sudden fear envelops you. I'm dying, is what your body is screaming at you. Your central nervous system lapses into convulsions. You kick and spasm, you scream, but the water, the hood, and the lack of air in your lungs won't let you. Your thoughts are racing. Time slows down as a natural result of your brain chemistry being deprived of oxygen. You have time to clearly experience the cold water flowing into your lungs, every nuance of your own nasal cavity being flooded, the straps holding your twisted body to the hard surface below you. You have time to experience the slow meaning of death. The very gates of hell are opening to you now as time slows to a standstill. Hundreds of painful, dreadful minutes tick by. You know that you are dying, but that doesn't make anything less painful for your gasping lungs. Your vision turns red, it becomes tunnel. Your eyes are bulging and your muscles are all fully flexed, and it fades to black. James Yee is a former U.S. Army chaplain and graduate of West Point who served as a Muslim chaplain for the U.S. prison camp in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, that would become the very controversial for its treatment of detainees designated as, quote, enemy combatants, unquote, by the U.S. government. And while ministering to prisoners at Guantanamo Bay, Captain Yee advised camp commanders on detainee religious practices and objected to the cruel and degrading abuses to which the prisoners were subjected. In June 2006, Chaplain Yee earned his master's degree in international relations. He now lectures about his harrowing ordeal at Guantanamo Bay. He's going to speak about that, about Islam, about the Asian American experience, and religious diversity issues, and the challenge of protecting both national security and civil liberties. Please welcome Chaplain James Yee.
Thank you very much. Can everyone hear? I'm the former U.S. Army Muslim chaplain who served in Guantanamo Bay, Chaplain James Yee. Today, Guantanamo Bay enters into its seventh year of existence. Seventh year. Human rights groups like Amnesty International has called Guantanamo the gulag of our time. The International Committee of the Red Cross said that the treatment in Guantanamo of prisoners has been tantamount to torture. Major newspaper editorials have called Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, a legal black hole. World leaders from around the world, from every corner of the globe, have denounced Guantanamo. But the leader of our country has created it. How is it that there are 2008 presidential candidates who support this betrayal of human rights and this betrayal of the rule of law? One candidate joked about sleep deprivation, an abusive tactic that is used in Guantanamo, while another candidate has said Guantanamo is necessary. And a third candidate has even said that he would double the size of Guantanamo. Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, has been defined in many different ways. Caged cells where prisoners are treated like animals. Prolonged solitary confinement, sometimes denial of sunlight. sleep deprivation, environmental manipulation, subjected to freezing cold temperatures and unbearable heat, brutal beatings by guards. And I've met Marines who have told me from their own mouths how they are not proud of having kicked in the heads of prisoners at Guantanamo. I've witnessed the bruises and the broken teeth of prisoners in Guantanamo. And I've witnessed prisoners in Guantanamo being dragged through the gravel. Sensory deprivation, chained, shackled, and hooded, like you see here. And I know firsthand how terrorizing and traumatizing this tactic of sensory deprivation is, as I was also subjected to sensory deprivation by my own government and by the military, which I patriotically serve. Sexual humiliation. Female interrogators who would grab the genitals of Muslim male prisoners and perform scandalous lap dances on prisoners as they sit shackled in an interrogation room. Religious abuse, desecration of the Holy Quran, forced shaving of Muslim beards, mock baptisms by interrogators posing as Catholic priests, utterly offensive to any Christian and any Catholic in this country or around the world. Desecration of religious symbols, Jewish religious symbols, to include the Star of David. Desecration of the Israeli flag in the interrogation rooms. Anti-Semitic suggestions to prisoners by U.S. personnel who suggested that Jewish pro bono attorneys cannot be trusted and that their Jewish faith is reason for them not to uphold their moral and ethical obligation to their clients. Religious discrimination in Guantanamo is unacceptable. Anti-Semitism in Guantanamo is unacceptable. Legal issues, indefinite detentions, kangaroo courts designed to convict prisoners, designed to bring about only guilty verdicts, secret evidence, hearsay evidence, coerced evidence, no legitimate form of full appeal. Then there's hunger strikes, suicides. Four prisoners have already committed suicide in Guantanamo. Mental and psychological deterioration of prisoners. We can go on and we can go on and on and on. But when do we say enough is enough? When will our government say enough is enough? When will the American people in this country say enough is enough? When the rest of the world already has. Today, I am saying enough is enough. And that's why, as I take off my jacket, I'm wearing an orange shirt. That says, shut down Guantanamo. Close Guantanamo. I'm wearing an orange shirt because Guantanamo is a place that needs to be closed down. Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, the prison camp at Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, is a mockery of 9/11. It's a mockery of the victims of 9/11 and their families, as our government has suggested that each and every one of these individuals who have been in Guantanamo is responsible for those terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center and on the Pentagon. This is not a reality. Guantanamo is not justice, not for the prisoners in Guantanamo, not for the victims of 9/11, and not for the families of those victims. We should not allow Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, to be a reason for those who hate America to kill and decapitate Americans in retaliation of how our government has abused prisoners in Guantanamo. Guantanamo Bay, Cuba continues to be a recruiting source for extremists. Colin Powell said, if it were up to me, I would close Guantanamo, not tomorrow, this afternoon. I am saying this afternoon, today, we should be closing Guantanamo. We should be closing Guantanamo. We should be closing Guantanamo. My name is Chaplain James Yee. I am the former U.S. Army Muslim chaplain who served in Guantanamo, and I say Guantanamo should be closed. Yes! Thank you.
This is a guy who's actually talked about torture. Jim McDermott signed the impeachment of Cheney, H.R. 333. He's traveled to Baghdad. He's had a lot of criticisms of this war, and he's here to talk to us today. Let's welcome Jim McDermott.
Thank you very much. I've also got a cold from flying on planes, so my voice is not very strong, but we're really here today because we care about our country and we care about human rights. America stands for many good things. But one thing that America must not stand for is the continued operation of Guantanamo Bay. Every minute that Guantanamo remains open, America, in my view, diminishes its moral authority in the world and it lowers its voice to a whisper in the defense of human rights. We cannot condemn the world when in fact we condone at home by keeping Guantanamo Bay open. You can't point at others when you've got it right in your own house. The President's Attorney General may not know what waterboarding is or that it's torture, but we know that it is. The President's Vice President, Dick Cheney, or I guess he's really the co-president if you want to think about it, may think that you can cover up behind a fence or shroud with secrecy, or deny that it exists, but all that is not enough to deny the American people what we know. You cannot deceive the American people. The truth is far more powerful than anything, and even Dick Cheney can't withstand the truth. We know the truth about Guantanamo Bay, just as we know the truth about Abu Ghraib. What you saw here is an image that you will never, never, never forget in your lifetime. That the United States of America was doing this to human beings. And nor will the rest of the world forget it. And that's why we're here today, joining thousands of Americans in other cities across the country right now who are raising their voices, calling on our government to close Guantanamo Bay. In a few days, we're going to come up to Martin Luther King's birthday. And he said once, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. And nothing is more clear when you think about Guantanamo Bay and Abu Ghraib. So long as the United States runs a prison like Guantanamo Bay, and as long as it remains open, injustice will remain a threat to everyone, and that is you and me. That's what we stand for. We are, as long as we keep that open, we're saying to the world, this is okay with us. Well, it isn't okay with me, This is, Guantanamo is a symbol of an administration's willingness to ignore and defy the Geneva Conventions. They came out of horrible experiences in war. And we sat down and decided what we were going to do in war. And we said certain things we will not do. President Bush comes and says, there's nothing I can't do. I'm president. Guantanamo, in my view, is a constant reminder of the administration's use of fear to rule us with an iron fist. Remember the code orange, the code red, all this stuff that they have done over and over and over again to make us afraid so that we'll accept Abu Ghraib and Guantanamo as though it's a necessity for our security. Our security does not lie in torturing other people. And Guantanamo is a black mark on America's resolve to defend human rights and civil liberties wherever they may be threatened. We make a lot of speeches about Darfur, and we make a lot of speeches about Rwanda, and we make speeches all over. But we run Guantanamo. And you can't have it both ways in life. America loses faith and face every day that Guantanamo remains open. We're here today on a Friday afternoon to defend our country by defending the Constitution, the due process, and the rule of law. We scream and holler about the rule of law for why don't the Iraqis and the Afghanis and all these people use the rule of law? But we have Guantanamo, and we avoid our own laws. This administration may have suspended the Geneva Convention at Guantanamo Bay, but we have the power to restore it. We believe that Guantanamo prison should be closed today. And we start with an international day of action. That's what this really is. We must not stop until there is an international day of human rights to mark the closure of a place that has come to represent all that is wrong with this administration and what is done in our country's name, and therefore lowers our standing in the world. I thank you all for coming out here today, because you are standing for the voiceless in the world. And if you're silent, then they have no one to speak for them. So thank you all very much for coming.
Freedom is coming, freedom is coming, freedom is coming, oh yes I know. Freedom is coming, freedom is coming, freedom is coming, oh yes I know. Oh yes I know, oh yes I know, oh yes I know. Justice is coming,
justice is coming. Oh. We shall overcome, we shall overcome.
Desegregation is against the Bible. I find my scripture for this in Genesis 9:27, where God did segregate and separate the three sons of Noah, sending one out to be a servant while the other two remained in the tabernacle. I say that God has given Noah in his Bible any right to men to end the curse that he placed upon any human flesh.
They are not going to get equal treatment.
Move on. Get back on the sidewalk. Move back then.
Yeah.
You are blocking the traffic and you
interfere in
the line.
No, I don't want you to leave. We have come to register the vote. We're willing to be beaten for democracy.
The day marks the beginning
of a determined, organized, mobilized campaign.
Certainly, I cannot stand here without thinking of 1955 and 56, when some 50,000 Negro citizens of this city decided that it was ultimately more honorable to walk in dignity than ride in humiliation.
Hello, Montgomery. It's 20 minutes after 10. I'm Ace Anderson behind the mic with the sounds you like. Here we go with John Lee Hooker.
Boom, 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 boom. I'm gonna shoot you right down.
I'm 5 years old, and I'm riding on the bus, and I can't sit down, and I'm asking my brother why. And then, you know, a white guy would get on and sit in the seat. And I said, if they sitting there.
That was the law back then.
On the 5th of December, 1955, fine, dignified, disciplined, courageous seamstress from this community was sitting down on a bus. Sister Rosa Parks, with dignity and discipline, said in substance that the cup of endurance has run over. I can take it no longer. Martin Luther, back in the 16th century, who said, here I stand and I can do none other, so help me God. It was Rosa Parks on the 1st of December said, here I sit and I can do none other, so help me God.
I had never even heard of Dr. King until that night. And I never got emotional in the church before in my life until that night. And I screamed out to the top of my voice, Lord, you have sent us a leader.
Are you ready for the question?
Now, the main question at the meeting was whether we should continue with the boycott.
All in favor, let it be known by standing on your feet.
I hope built the country, and I fought for it too. Now I guess that you can see what a black man have to do. This is, if you was white, you'd be all right. If you was brown, stick around. But as you black, brother, get back.
Another thing I want to say to you is that hate isn't our weapon either. And I'm not talking now about a weak love. It would be nonsense to urge oppressed people to love their oppressors in an affectionate sense. I'm not talking about that. Too many people confuse the meaning of love when they go to criticizing the love ethic. I'm talking about a love that is so strong that it becomes a demanding love. I'm talking about a love that is so strong that it organizes itself into a mass movement. Says somehow, I am my brother's keeper. And he's so wrong that I'm willing to suffer and die if necessary to get him right and to see that he's on the wrong road.
You are ordered to disperse. See that they disperse.
atmosphere in the town was strange because it was as though, you know, the white people of Montgomery, Alabama had got their feelings hurt. You know, they just not understand, you know, how their former slaves, whom they loved so much, could be guilty of such a tremendous repudiation.
Thank you.